need to study about the different procedures possible for the patient. Having selected the correct procedure, we need to execute the procedure correctly. And lastly, we need to follow up meticulously, like in all surgery, especially hand surgery, you need to follow up completely to get good results, to get complete function of the hand which has been affected by ulnar nerve palsy. So that is what we're going to do. I am not going to go into the details of what to do when there is a combined ulnar nerve palsy and median nerve palsy, or combined ulnar nerve palsy and radial nerve palsy. I'm going to go only into pure ulnar nerve palsy, either low ulnar nerve palsy or high ulnar nerve palsy. Now, the first is, we shall try to understand the dynamics of the loss of the ulnar nerve. Now, normally, that day I told you, the metacarpophalangeal joint flex, that is done by the intrinsics. Then the flexion superficial is flex, that is done by the for the IP joint flexion. Then the FDP and the opponent's minimi. This cupping occurs. This happens. And then flexion with increased concavity to increase the power. This power grip is caused. Here in ulnar nerve palsy, the flexion of the MP joints is lost. The flexion of the FDS is lost. Why is this lost? Is when there is a combined, only if there's a question mark there, only if there is a combined median nerve, we need to remember this also. And then the FDP and opponent's digitae minimi is lost. And on the ring of little fingers, the FDP is usually intact, but may be lost in high ulnar nerve palsy. And the flexion of the increased concavity of the metacarpal arch, even that is lost because the reversal of the metacarpal arch occurs. So the patient cannot adopt the initial lumbrical position, cannot grasp large objects. So the power grip is lost, but he can grasp smaller objects. But even in doing so, that pressure on the tips of the fingers is very high. So that may cause trophic ulcers, especially on the tips of the fingers. Trophic ulcers develop mainly on the tips of the fingers and on the metacarpal heads. That is where the pressure is maximum. So now we have understood the dynamics. What do we need to do now to correct all this? Now, we need to do two things. We need to improve the function, obviously, and we also need to improve the cosmesis. As far as improving function is concerned, in a low ulnar palsy, we have to correct the finger cloying. This will not work. We have seen how this will not work. Second, we need to restore the normal pattern of finger flexion, that is MCP joint first. So we need to replace the MCP joint flexion. And then sometimes we may need to replace the IP joint extension also. Then we need to improve the thumb pinch. And then we need to reverse the reversal of the metacarpal arch. We have to get back the cupped hand. And in a high ulnar nerve palsy, there is one extra problem in that the DIP joint flexion of the ring and little fingers will be affected. That has to be corrected. And to improve appearance, that is much later, the wasting of the intraosseous muscles. Even if you get back function, the wasting of the intraosseous muscles on the dorsum of the hand will lead to stigma. So that can also be corrected with fat grafting. Now, so let us boil it down to bare essentials of what we need to do in an ulnar nerve palsy. First, we need to correct the finger cloying, MCP joint flexion, IP joint extension. Second, we need to correct the reversal of the metacarpal arch. Third, we need to improve thumb pinch. So you have to replace adductor, abductor of the index. That we will see. So these are our three aims. Now, we need to select the procedure. There are two types of procedures, static and dynamic. Static techniques only correct the hyperextension. So this hyperextension is corrected and the MCP joints are stabilized or kept in minimal flexion, so that the extensor, long extensor, can extend the IP joint. That's all. So this procedure is only a static. It will not do any movement. Dynamic techniques are those that actively flex the MCP joint. The static technique flex the MCP joint by a procedure by which does not move. Dynamic techniques actively flex the MCP joint and can sometimes even extend the IP joints. So now, again, we'll go through the Bouvier test, because this is going to tell us what procedure to do. So when we stabilize the MCP joint, extension is naturally possible. So this is positive. If the Bouvier test is positive, the procedure that is going to be done is a static procedure. If the Bouvier test is negative and there is still a deficit after doing a Bouvier test, that is the assisted angle. We have seen also the contracture angle, assisted angle, unassisted angle. If the contracture angle is present, you need to splint it or do a surgical release so that there is no contracture. If there is a contracture, obviously no tendon transfer can make it straight. So the contracture angle must be brought to 0 degrees, and then you will have you may have an assisted angle. If there is an assisted angle, you may have to bring it down either with splints or with surgical procedures, strengthening the central slip to make it to 0 degrees. Sometimes it may not be possible to bring it to 0 degrees because the central slip itself, because of long-standing claw, the central slip might have become weakened. There may be no need to do surgery, but you will have to do a dynamic tendon transfer so that this can also be addressed. So splinting or dynamic tendon transfer. When this comes to zero, then we have to think about the unassisted angle of 40 degrees. So that you can do the static or dynamic tendon transfer, which can be done together.
You can still hear him.
The tendon transfer, we usually do for two conditions, Hansen's disease and in traumatic palsy. The common question is, if there is a claw of only the ring and little fingers, should we do a tendon transfer for all the fingers or should we do a tendon transfer only for the ring and little fingers? In the condition with Hansen's disease, all the four fingers should be operated on. Right. Because it is difficult to operate later. Supposing now it is a Hansen's, it is an ongoing process sometimes. The median nerve may be involved, the lubricants of the index and finger may fail, and he may develop a total claw afterwards. So it is better to correct all four. Then the tendon graft in the lumbrical canal does not cause any deleterious effect to the already functioning lumbricals to the index and midfinger. And thirdly, when you operate on only two fingers and do a tendon transfer for two fingers, the patient feels a weakness in the hand, in the unoperated fingers, because there is a different force that is acting on the operated fingers. In a traumatic palsy, you can do only the ring a little fingers, but there is a problem in that for coordinated movements of all the fingers, it is better if you have a single motor acting on all four fingers. So again, it is better if all four fingers are addressed at the same time when doing a tendon transfer. Now, the timing of tendon transfer, before we go into the different techniques, we'll see the timing. It is dependent on the motor recovery. Sometimes when you have an injury, you've done a repair and you don't know how long to wait. This is the commonest question. How long should I wait? Now, if it is close to the target, or if it is a younger patient, shorter nerve defects, those without significant associated injuries, they have a better chance of getting a useful results. But if it is much more proximal, if the injury is proximal, then or there has been a crush injury and there has been a loss, we have had to put a nerve graft, then the procedure becomes different. The tendon transfer can be done early. And what is early? Is it 1 month? Is it 2 months? It depends on the need of the patient and the tissues, how they react. If it is, you can even do a tendon transfer at the end of 2 months after doing a high ulnar nerve repair, because it is better to get back function early. Now, we have seen that there are two types of procedures, static procedures and dynamic procedures. We'll see the static procedures. Now, the principle of static procedures is the metacarpopharyngeal joint is stabilized or kept in flexion. That's all. Nothing else will happen. The function of the long flexors, extensors is not modified. They act on their own. Whatever work they were doing, they continue to do. But the disadvantage is no active MP joint flexion is provided. And now these are static procedures with time, with wear and tear of the tissues that you're using. You may have a failure of the procedure. So these procedures are usually done when you have a problem. You don't have enough motors. And the function, it's a very long-standing ulnar nerve palsy. There are five types of static procedures. One is A1 pulley release. Second is fasciodermodesis. All these aim at bringing the MCP joint into flexion, except the first one. We will see the first one later. The fasciodermodesis, capsulodesis, tenodesis, arthrodesis, right? Now, these are the five main static procedures done for ulnar nerve palsy. Now, what is this flexor pulley advancement? Now, when you release, you've got an A1 pulley at the level of the metacarpophalangeal joint. This helps close to the joint. So, the flexor digitorum profundus and flexor digitorum superficial cannot act on the MCP joint. They act on the MCP joint only when the other joints are completely flexed, then they act on the MCP joint. To prevent that and cause a bowstringing, so that when the momentum becomes long, the joint will be acted on by the flexors first. So that is called the flexor pulley advancement described by Bunnell. That is, we release the A1 pulley over here up to the middle of the A1 pulley. So the tendon bowstrings, and when a tendon bowstrings, it acts first on that joint. It is ineffective, but it is enough to stabilize the MCP joint. Second, fascia dermodesis. It is very simple. You just excise skin over here and suture it like this. So what happens now? MCP joints have been kept in flexion. Once the MCP joints are stabilized in flexion, the long extensor will help to extend the IP joints that we have seen in the Bouvier test. The third is the capsulodesis. Capsulodesis is of two types. One is Zancoli's capsulodesis. He just made an incision in the capsule of the metacarpophalangeal joint, just excised a portion and sutured it so that the MCP joint again comes into flexion. So then there was the Omer modification of the Zancoli capsulodesis. So the second capsulodesis is the Omer modification, where there is an excision of the volar plate of the capsule on either side, and it is brought down and sutured to the bone. There is a drill hole made in the bone, and the suturing of the capsule is done. So this maintains longer and it doesn't relax with time. I told you sometimes these procedures, the soft tissue stretch with time. Here, when it is attached to the bone, it is a little stronger and can stay put for a longer period of time. Then we come to the tenodesis. There are a few different types of tenodesis. First is the static tenodesis of Riordan. That is, they use the ECRL and the ECU tendons. Distally based flaps are taken like this, taken over here and sutured at this. Now, all these tendons that are used for tenodesis go volar to the deep metacarpal ligament, deep transverse metacarpal ligament, so that it keeps the MCP joint in flexion. So this is the original technique of static tenodesis described by Riordan. But there was a better modification called the Parks static tenodesis, where a tendon graft is used to transfer the transverse carpal ligament, passing volar to the, it's sutured over here and sutured to the deep transverse metacarpal ligaments or into the radial lateral bands of each of the fingers. So what happens? This holds it like that, or it can be sutured to the extensor retinaculum. The next is the Omer modification of the Parkes tenodesis, where it is sutured to the two bands, that is the ulnar lateral band of the index finger and the radial lateral band of the mid finger. And for the little finger and ring finger, it is sutured on either side to get some amount of tenodesis effect and bringing the fingers together. Then we have the wrist tenodesis of Fowler. So here again, here it uses the dorsal side where it is sutured. I was telling you about the extensor retinaculum. The suturing is done to the extensor retinaculum and then it is brought here. Now this is a type of a dynamic tenodesis, because when he flexes the wrist, the fingers go in for extension. When he extends the wrist, fingers go in for flexion. This is called the dynamic tenodesis. When there is a graft or a tendon graft or any graft that is going across two joints, movement, and this is attached to an immobile structure, that is the extensor retinaculum. Distally, it is attached to the lumbrical canals, to the radial lateral bands of the fingers. So this causes a tenodesis effect. And it is a dynamic tenodesis, because when he flexes this, the MCP joints extend. When he extends the wrist, MCP joints flex. Then lastly, we come to the bone blocks. Now, bone blocks can be of two types. You can insert a bone block inside on the dorsal aspect to prevent it from extending. So that will allow it flexion, further flexion from that point. The second procedure is the arthrodesis, which is usually not done because it totally cripples the hand. It keeps the MCP joint in flex position, in the fixed position. It cannot flex, it cannot extend. So that it is the last preferred procedure. Now, we have seen the different types of static procedures. Pulley advancement. Then second, the pulley advancement described by Bunnell. Then we spoke about the fascia dermodesis. Then we spoke about the capsulodesis. Then we spoke about the tenodesis. Then we spoke about the arthrodesis or the bony block techniques. Now we come to the dynamic. So when do we do these static procedures? The static procedures are actually enough when your Bouvier test is positive, when he's able to do this. But the problem is, by doing a static procedure for all the patients who have a Bouvier test positive, the problem is the strength of the hand will not be improved. Only a dynamic tendon transfer will improve the strength of the hand. So we can plan for a dynamic tendon transfer. We shall now see what are all the available dynamic tendon transfers. We shall classify them because there are many procedures. And we shall classify them and try to understand for which sort of patient which procedure is done. Now, these techniques prevent the hyperextension of the metacarpophalangeal joint and have the ability to extend the PIP joint by inserting onto the lateral bands. So they can actively flex the MCP joint, they can actively extend the PIP joint. So when you're talking about any tendon transfer, dynamic tendon transfer, we need to talk about three things. What is the motor you're going to use? What is the route you're going to use? And what is the insertion you're going? Because every single motor has got its own advantages, disadvantages. There are different routes that can be followed. For a single motor, you can go on the volar side, you can go on the dorsal side. Or the insertion. Every single type of insertion will have a different type of action. So it depends on what you want to achieve. So the motors, we can classify the motors used for dynamic tendon transfer into four types. Wrist flexors, wrist extensors, finger flexors, finger extensors. Very simple. And in exceptions, you cannot use some of these. For instance, you cannot use the flexor carpi radialis, obviously, if there is a problem of the median nerve also. And if you cannot use the FDS, if there's a high ulnar nerve palsy, because the FTP also would have been paralyzed for the ring finger. So the roots, what are the roots? The roots can be volar. Then they go through the palm. They can, if they go on the palmar aspect, they have to go through the lumbrical canal. If they go on the dorsal aspect, they have to go through the intraosseous space. Then they have to go through the volar to the deep transverse metacarpal ligament. All transfers have to go volar to the deep transverse metacarpal ligament. We need to remember this because if it goes dorsal to the dorsal deep transverse metacarpal ligament, it becomes an extensor, it becomes worse. So you have to go volar to the deep transverse, only then it flexes. The transverse will flex the MCP joint. And so we have seen the motor, the different motors, the wrist flexors, the finger flexors, the wrist extensors, and the finger extensors. Now we'll see the insertion. The insertion can be into the bone, that is the proximal phalanx. It can be into the fibrous flexor sheath. It can be into the lateral bands. Or it can be into the intraosseous tendon, which is a little more proximal and more specific. And in the fibrous flexor sheath, you can have insertion into the A1 pulley, the A2A pulley, that is the proximal portion, or the entire A2 pulley. And the lateral bands, you can insert it either into the radial side or the lateral side or the ulnar side. So we'll keep all these in mind when we go to the study of the different transfers. Now, there are certain standard procedures. We shall see all these features, just understand what these procedures. I'm not going to go into the details of how they are done. We will try to understand what they do and how they achieve the correction of the claw. Now, first is we will discuss about the use of finger flexors. As you know, the commonest finger flexor used for ulnar nerve palsy correction is the flexor digitorum superficialis. It was Stiles and Brown who gave the first description. They used the FDS of each finger to transfer to the extensor side through the volar to the deep transverse metacarpal ligament to bring about MP joint flexion. But this was too powerful. The tension fraction of the flexor distal superficial is 2.0. The tension fraction of the intrinsic muscles is 0.5. That means it is 4 times as powerful as the intrinsic that it has to replace. So obviously this became very powerful and it would cause a deformity. This is called an intrinsic plus deformity. The deformity that occurs in ulnar palsy is intrinsic minus deformity. It causes an intrinsic plus deformity, which is more difficult to correct. Then Bunnell modified it by rerouting both slips to both radial ulnar bands, and he used a single flexor. Now, the problems of these are adhesions and the prime PIP flexor. Now, the FDS is primarily a flexor of the proximal interphalangeal joint. This is converted into an extensor. And the problem, as I said, intrinsic plus deformity may occur. So, Stiles-Bunnell procedure was modified by Littler. So, it's called the modified Stiles-Bunnell procedure. The modification was done by Littler. The FDS of the ring or the midfinger are used. It is split into 2 or 4 slips passed from the palm through the lumbrical canal inserted into the lateral bands. It is contraindicated in hypermobile lax joints. It cannot be done when there is an associated high ulnar nerve, when it's a high ulnar nerve palsy. It is usually ideally done in hands with stiffer fingers and the procedures can be done in manual laborers also, because when you take away the flexor of the PIP joint, there tends to be a weakness of the flexion. So the extension becomes more powerful. When you insert the same tendon that you've taken away into the lateral bands and try to get extension, you are adding to the extension power. It will go in for a hypermobile joints. So it will go for a deformity and it will become a weaker hand. So it will reduce the power of the hand. So the modified Stiles Bunnell, as I said, cannot be done in high ulnar palsy and combined high-median ulnar palsy. It can cause PIP hyperextension deformity. Sometimes flexion contracture can be caused because of the FDS stump that you're retaining back may cause a contracture. So it is done only in patients with mild PIP contractures or stable fingers without passive hyperextension. There should be no passive hyperextension at the PIP joint. The modifications of this are the different types of insertions that you can do. I told you can insert it into the proximal phalanx. That was described by Burkhalter. You can insert into the A1 pulley, described by Riordan. The basic thing is you use the FDS of the middle or the ring fingers. Next, we come to the lasso procedure. Lasso is what they used to catch the cattle. And this is something like that. This was described by Zancoli. Again, this uses the flexor distorum superficialis. The flexor distorum superficialis is split into 4 and inserted through the pulley, through the A1 or A2 pulley. And each slip is tunneled and sutured to itself. The tendon is sutured. So this brings about flexion at the MCP joint. A weak flexion of the MCP joint is brought about to stabilize the MCP joint so that the extension can occur by the long extensors. We have seen the finger flexor, which is the flexor distorum superficialis. Now we'll see the use of the finger extensors. Fowler's procedure is the usually done procedure where we can use the extensor indices proprius and extensor digiti minimi. The extensor indices proprius is split over here, harvested, taken out proximally here, then brought to the volar side and sutured to the lateral bands for the index and midfingers. Similarly, it is done for the extensor digiti minimi. The ulnar slip is taken and the same is split and used for flexion of the metacarpophalangeal joint. This is called the Fowler's procedure. Now, we come to the use of the wrist extensors. The commonly used done procedure is the Paul Brand's EE40 or EF40. Now, this is an extensor to flexor four-tailed graft. That is, the extensor that is taken is the extensor carpi radialis longus tendon, that is the motor. the route that is taken can be either brand one procedure through the dorsal intraosseous space, that is the extensor route, or it becomes, it's called the EF4T when it's brand two procedure, that is through the carpal tunnel and the flexor route. Whatever route it takes, I told you, when it goes on the volar side, it goes along the lumbrical canals. When it goes on the dorsal side, it goes along the intraosseous spaces. And where the insertion is can be decided. So now, when you're taking this beam descendant transfer, you can do the insertion into the lateral bands. Usually, what we do is the lateral band of the index finger, the ulnar band of the index finger, mid and ring, and little finger on the radial side. Now we come to the use of this. The palmar is longest and the second is the flexor carpi radialis. Now the flexor carpi, the palmar is longest four tail transfer was described by Fritschi, and he described using the palmar is longest lengthened with the tendon graft. The same thing, what you do, insert into the lateral bands. Please remember, the commonest insertion is into the lateral bands, and it is inserted in the lateral bands. It can be used, it's a very weak muscle, but it can be used for young patients with hypermobile joints. That is, the joints are very soft and supple, and any powerful muscle that is used will lead to a deformity. Overcorrection is a problem in ulnar nerve palsy surgery. Undercorrection may be accepted, but overcorrection is very difficult to correct. And much weaker donor muscle than the ECRL, but it can be used in certain sort of patients like young patients with hypermobile fingers. Next, we talk about the flexor carpi radialis transfer, which was described by Riordan. It can be useful. Now, that day I was telling you, some patients, when you ask them to extend the finger, they sometimes flex the wrist in an attempt to be able to extend the fingers. In those sort of patients who are already trying to use the flexors of the wrist to extend the fingers, this can be used. But of course, it cannot be used in a high ulnar nerve palsy, because in a high ulnar nerve palsy, the flexor carpi ulnaris is already paralyzed. So if you're going to take away the flexor carpi radialis also, the wrist becomes very weak. There is no flexion possible. So the FCR can be used. Again, it is split into four slips, passed through the intraosseous spaces and into the lateral bands. Now, we have seen about procedures, dynamic procedures that correct the MCP joint flexion and interphalangeal joint extension. If you want MCP joint flexion alone, we suture it to the A1 pulley. If you want a little bit of extension of the IP joint also, you suture it to the lateral bands. If you want more amount of IP joint extension than MCP joint flexion, you go more distally to the dorsum of the PPX region, the extensor aspect. Now, the more distally you go, the more amount of extension of the IP joint, the more proximally you insert it, the more amount of action on the metacarpophalangeal joint. So it depends on what you want. If sometimes on Bouvier's test, patient is not able to completely extend and it is quite stiff and patient surgery needs to be done, then you can use a more distal insertion where it will act more on the IP joint extension and counteract that stiffness. Now, we come to the next part, how to correct the metacarpal arch. If you do the procedures that we have already spoken about, patients will be very happy because they can get a lumbrical position. Your tendon transfer will work well, they'll get a lumbrical position. But in our country, the patients will come to you, especially if it's on the right hand, they will come to you with the complaint that they are not able to eat rice with this hand, with the reconstructed hand, because you are not able to cup. You need to cup for us to eat rice with our hands. We need to adduct the fingers. We need to cup the hand and then you take the rice. They will say specifically they are able to eat idli or rotis, but not rice. So for this correction of the metacarpal arch, we have got certain procedures. The first is Palande's procedure, then Bunnell's T operation, then Rani's extensor digitae minimae transfer and Omer's procedure. Now, the Palande's procedure or intrinsic reactivation procedure. is nothing but EF5T. We have already seen EF4T, extensor to flexor. Now here, it corrects the reversal of the metacarpal arch, and this is the only thing is, it is a modification of the Brand procedure, and the motor is the same, but the insertion is different. Here, the insertion is into five tails, not four tails, into five tails now, and each tail is not inserted in the lateral bands. What we want to achieve is, it must be inserted into the intrachea. That is, the intrachea have a common insertion. They start forming the tendon of insertion at the level of the base of the proximal pharynx. This must be dissected out. You make an incision over here. This is dissected out, and that is sutured. So we have to attach one over here, two, three, four, and one on this side of the little finger. So there are five insertions, starting from the radial side of the index, between index and mid the intrachea, between mid and ring the intrachea, between ring and little the intrachea, and on the ulnar border of the little finger. So this brings about cupping, and this will get a better result and more satisfied patient. Then we have the Bunnell's T procedure. This is another simple procedure where the FDS is harvested. A tendon graft is attached from here to here, from both the ulnar border to the radial border. And the tendon is attached here. When this moves, when this contracts, what was the T over here becomes a Y. It is pulled like that, and these two ends come together. When these two ends come together, there is a cupping of the hand that is achieved. So that is the basis of the Bunnell's T procedure, where the T that is formed by the tendon insertion becomes a Y on contraction. Then we have the extensor digiti minimi transfer, that is to address the reversal of the metacarpal arch again. Here the extensor digiti minimi is used as a motor. It was described by Rani and later modified by Omer. Now, this is, as we have seen, this is very important. This Palande's procedure was described by Dinkar Palande, of course, is an Indian. And he has done extensive work on the leprosy hand. And the tail is attached to each pair of intrachea, that is palmar and dorsal, tied together. And once they're tied together, as I told you, the five slips are inserted. This is the Bunnell's T procedure. We have seen this. Now, we have corrected the MCP joint flexion, that is the flexion cascade we have corrected by our dynamic transfer to the lateral bands or the A1 pulley or the dorsal aspect. And then we corrected the metacarpal arch reversal by using the Palande's intrinsic reactivation procedure or the Bunnell's T procedure. Now we need to address the third problem. Patient does not have a pinch. Now, to have a key pinch, there must be a good adduction and there must be a good abduction of the index finger. Both must come against each other with power. Only then there will be a powerful key pinch. This is not possible because the adductor is paralyzed and the first dorsal intrachea muscle is paralyzed. So this can be achieved by three procedures. The FDS of the ring finger can be used. This is the Littler's procedure using the FDS tendon. Or we can use the extensor carpi radialis brevis or the brachioradialis or the ECRL. So here you can make out the FDS is taken, a pulley is created over here, and it's inserted into the insertion of the adductor on the thumb. So this is using the extensor carpi radialis brevis, which is taken to get the adduction. This adduction is achieved. Now the next thing you need to get is abduction also. There are two components of key pinch. One is thumb adduction and index finger abduction. The thumb adduction can be achieved by reinforcing the adductor, and the index abduction can be achieved by four or five procedures. The extensor indices proprius can be used. The EPB can be used. There are different procedures. What we need to understand today is only the technique. What is it that we need to do and how it can be done? Actually, even the FDS of the ring finger can be used. When you're using the FDS of the fingers, the FDS of the middle and ring fingers can be used. The FDS of one finger can be used for the lasso procedure. The other FDS can be split into two, and one for the adduction and one for the abduction of the index finger. So all are corrected at the same time. Now, there is one more sign that we need to correct. That is, I told you last time that some patients present with only this. That is, they're not able to bring their little finger together. So this is done. So this also, you may have done a fantastic procedure, but the patients may not be satisfied because this finger is not coming together. So there is a tendon, there is a transfer described for this. It is a variation of the Fowler's. Remember, in Fowler's procedure, we use the extensor digitale minimi to do a flexion of the metacarpopharyngeal joint. Here, the same extensor digitale minimi is taken past volar to the deep transverse metacarpal ligament and sutured into the insertion of the radial collateral ligament on the base of the proximal side, on the radial side. So when this happens, it's attached over here and this brings the little finger closer to the ring finger. So we are using the extensor digitale minimi for correction of this abduction deformity. In a high ulnar palsy, I told you there is one more problem. The FDP of the ring and little are not powerful enough. To do this, what can be done is the side-to-side tenorrhaphy. Already, these three tendons, the middle ring and little fingers, have got tendinous interconnections between them. All we have to do is strengthen these tendinous interconnections, and then we are able to get back IP joint, DIP joint flexion at the ring and little fingers. Now, we need to talk about internal splinting. What is internal splinting? Early tendon transfer with nerve repair prevents development of deformity and development of contractures. So, if you are going to do repair, high ulnar nerve palsy, a repair of the ulnar nerve in the elbow, it is going to take quite some time for it to reach the hand. Is it possible for the patient to wait for such a long time? Or can we do some procedure which can help the patient to go on with his work, maybe with a little weakness? At the same time, the procedure should be done in such a way that when the nerve recovers, there should be no problem of re-innervation. So that sort of procedure is called the internal splinting. Normally, we advise the patient to wear a claw correction splint during the procedure, after the procedure of nerve repair. However, patient may not be, and second is wearing a claw correction splint may not allow him to work because it's going to be cumbersome. If you do what is known as an internal, the splint is applied inside, and usually the flexor distal superficial is used for this of the middle finger, not the ring finger, because in a high ulnar nerve palsy, we cannot use the FDS of the mid finger, a ring finger. Now, the transfer, it functions as an internal splint for the paralyzed muscles. It becomes also a permanent solution in case the nerve repair that has been done does not function. Now, it is the FDS of the ring or mid finger. Here, usually, if it is done for a high ulnar nerve palsy, the ring finger cannot be used. It is split into two. And then it is split into the A and it attached to the A1 pulley, inserted to the A1 pulley to just achieve MP joint stabilization. So it is acting something like a lasso procedure. Now, we have seen a number of procedures that can be done. For we saw about procedures that are done for MCP joint for getting back the power grasp. We saw about procedures, static procedures. Then we saw about different procedures for thumb pinch. We saw about procedures for correcting the metacarpal arch. What is the procedure? How do we select the procedure for the patient, for the individual patient? We need to select the procedure according to, we need to analyze the occupation. Is he a sedentary worker or a heavy manual laborer? What is the status of the PAP joint? What is the construct of the fingers? Are the fingers short and stubby or are they long and slender? We need to be very careful in choosing the tendon because two powerful tendons can cause more harm than good. Hand dominance, is it left or right? Motor assessment, what is working, what is not? I told you when there is a Hansen's, the median nerve also may be involved. So we need to be very careful when you are choosing the motor. Then, as I said, the angles, the unassisted angle and contracture angle must be assessed. And lastly, we need to discuss with the patient and the therapist. Now, if hypermobile joints are very minimal unassisted angle, a pulley advancement and capsular, very minimal procedure is ideal. If short fingers, assisted angle is present, you need to do a powerful transfer. So hypermobile joints, do a less powerful procedure. A pulley advancement is enough. if short fingers and assisted angle is present, and then you can use, and the FDP or FDS weakness is there, the EF40, the Brand's procedure, is ideal because it's a very powerful tendon transfer. If the assisted angle is zero, avoid four tail procedures. There are certain procedures you need to avoid. If it is zero, if the assisted angle is zero, avoid this, because when you're doing a four tail, it's going to add to the extension at the PIP joint. Already the patient has got a good PIP joint extension because we saw that the assisted angle is zero. If you're going to add a tendon transfer there, it may lead to a hyperextension deformity. If there is an FDP or FDS weakness, it is better to use an extensor from the wrist, that is EF40 or EE40. Now, if you want only MCP joint flexion, that is the main thing, that is Bouvier's maneuver, full extension of IP joints you achieve, you can do the A1 pulley insertion. As I said, avoid inserting into the extensor apparatus. If you do that, you're going to add to the extension at the IP joints, which will make it worse. So other insertions can be thought of. If both MCP joint and MCP joint flexion and IP joint extension are needed, especially in long-standing cases where there is some amount of stiffness of the PIP joint or there's an attenuation of the central slip, the insertion can be into the lateral bands, the dorsal base of the middle phalanx. You can even go in distally or combine intraosseous tendons, as we saw in the Palande's intrinsic reactivation procedure. So the best results will be obtained in hands of well-motivated younger persons, recent deformity, that is less than 3 years, no stiffness of the finger joints, no or very little hyperextension at the PAP joints. If there is going to be hyperextension of the PAP joints, the tendon transfer may work well, but the hand may not be very functional. And if there is no assisted angle and there is no weakness of the forearm muscles. Lastly, what do we do to execute the surgery correctly? We have selected the correct procedure. We have selected the correct patient. Now, how do we execute the surgery correctly? That is the technical aspect. There is one important step in doing a tendon transfer. Harvesting the tendon, harvesting, identifying the insertion are all very easy. The most important thing is tension adjustment. Now, we need to, the suturing must be done in such a way that the tension is adjusted correctly. The index and little are usually sutured first, the middle and ring at zero tension. Keep a watch on the finger slackness during suturing. Now, it is sometimes people we use what is known as a splint. Now, this splint keeps it in this position. What we need to remember is the position of the wrist and the position of the metacarpophalangeal joints. The general rule of the thumb is the sum of these two must be equal to 90 degrees. If the wrist is kept in neutral position, the MCP joints must be kept in 90 degrees. If the wrist is kept in extension of 30 degrees, this or the wrist is kept flexed, it's kept at 30 degrees, this must be kept at 60 degrees. Now, this or this. Now, when you're keeping the wrist neutral, MCP joint must be at 90 degrees and IP joints must be kept straight. This is the position that must be adhered to. Lastly, we have done a good tension adjustment. We have finished the procedure. We need to follow up meticulously. Immobilization. In what POP do we immobilize? We need to immobilize in a bivalve POP. They used to make a cast and bivalve it. Usually, you can do a volar POP and a dorsal POP to completely protect the transfer. The POP is usually removed at the end of 3 weeks. We start active mobilization, but night cross splinting to be continued for another 3 weeks before complete power movements are allowed. Now, we come to the last portion. There's one more surgical aspect of ulnar nerve palsy, that is decompression neuropathy. Now, we have seen the commonest are cubital tunnel, ulnar tunnel at the Guyon's canal. So, as far as the cubital tunnel is concerned, there are different options like medial epicondylectomy and anterior subcutaneous transposition of the ulnar nerve. I think there is no time. I wanted to show a surgery, how the anterior transposition is done and how the facial sling is prepared. But we'll go into that if we have time later. So, the end point of all this is selecting the correct surgery for the correct patient. An average technique will get better results than an inappropriately chosen procedure executed perfectly. You need to choose the correct surgery that will work for the particular patient. So that is the, after studying all these, after knowing about the different types of tendon transfer, this is the conclusion. Now we will finish the discussion of two cases. This patient who had a laceration. There was a lot of discussion about this case. Actually, these two cases, that is yesterday and today, I have shown two cases, yesterday one and today one, and both are actually my complications. And what we need to understand from complications are, we need to understand why it went wrong and what should have been done to prevent what went wrong. So now look at this, it looks quite innocent actually. This is the X-ray that shows the fracture, comminuted fracture of the proximal phalanx. Now the questions were, how would you manage the injury and how would you follow up? Now management, as far as the management, lot of the answers that we got were, was there a problem of viability? No, there was not a problem of viability. Was there a skin loss? No, there is no skin loss. It is only a burst wound on the finger. There is no skin loss. Was there a loss of flexor tendons? No, the flexor tendons are intact. Was there a loss of the flexor sheath? No, the flexor sheath was also intact. Was there an extensor injury? No, the extensor was also intact. Then what about the index and thumb? The index was amputated at the level of the base of the PPX. Some people also suggested a ray amputation. That can be done later if the patient asks for it. It is not done primarily. So we are worried only about the middle finger. Now what if all these are intact? Then what is the problem with the mid finger, the injured finger? There are only two things. One is there is a skin laceration which has occurred from a burst wound. Second is fractures, underlying fractures. So following this concept, I have this concept of S3M2R, that is the first S, most important in hand surgery, whether it's an acute management or whether it's a chronic hand wound or electrical burns or whatever. First S is skin. The second S is skeleton. Here, both S1 and S2 are involved. When these two are involved, we need to be very careful because you will find certain things happened in this patient. We did, all that we did was we did a skin suturing and we gave a POP for 2 weeks for the wound to heal. And then we advised him splinting and he was lost. He came back after 3 months and I'll show you how it was. So this is what I was telling you about. We gave a POP, we advised splinting, everything was done. This was at the end of suturing, right? Now, when he came back after 2 months, he had excellent flexion. But this was what had happened. He developed a contracture. Why did this contracture develop now? We need to analyze retrospectively. Was it the skin problem or was it the bone problem? Obviously, nothing else can cause this problem. So, retrospective analysis, skin laceration on the mid-volar aspect. Okay, it is running through all the joint creases. That goes against the principle. That is, you should not have a wound on the front of the volar aspect, in the middle. It will definitely go for contracture. There is a burst injury, there was a lot of edema. So, there is going to be more inflammation. That is going to add to the problem. Underlying fracture is going to heal. You know the single wound concept. Everything heals is a mass. So it tends to contract. When fractured segments are there, they tend to collapse because there's nothing holding them together. They collapse. That adds to the contracture. And the need for splinting was not addressed. Need for splinting includes a straight POP for the MCP joint. We have been talking about two or three cases where you need a immobilization of the MCP joint in neutral position. Now look at this. The wound is crossing the MCP joint on the volar aspect. So obviously, we should have predicted that it is going to go in for a contracture, especially with the underlying comminuted fracture. So inadequate splinting, there was a need for splinting, there was a need for total straightening splint. You know what a total straightening splint from the tip of the finger up to the palm. And follow up of for 3 months with these splints with intermittent mobilization would have got a better result. So this case was presented because it is an apparently simple case, just a skin suturing and the fracture has been molded. But what happens is each, the skin wound that is running across the joints is prone for contracture. We should recognize this. This is something. Now, just suturing it is not a big problem, but how to prevent, the whole aim is getting back function. And this we have failed in this patient. So this is the lesson to be learned. Note where the skin laceration is, note the fracture, and think about what can happen in the long run. Now, this is the other case. Before we discuss about that, the other case, multiple lacerations. Now, this also invited a lot of discussion. Now, when you discuss about this, you can make out that the tendon is cut and different levels, actually, the tendon has been cut. So, obviously, and you can make out the fractures over here also. Now, what do we do for this? You can make out a fracture on the terminal phalanx also and the proximal phalanx head. How, the same thing. How would you manage? How would you follow up? Now, the problems are thumb viable. It is viable at present. It must be considered. The second problem is bipedical skin flaps. Will they be viable? Now, there is a question. There was a question of about whether the palmar skin is attached. The palmar skin was attached on the ulnar border, ulnar side. So, the blood supply was coming from two pedicles. But the bipedical flaps were quite long enough. There were multiple comminuted fractures of the proximal phalanx and of the metacarpal and of the carpal bones. Then extensor tendon injury, EPL, EPB, multiple levels, query avulsion also. So now these are the problems which we had to address. Now there are two ways. Basically, there are two ways of handling this problem. I call one as the passive route. That is, you don't do anything. You try to preserve the skin, try to fix the fractures. If something goes wrong, debride and flap. And plan for extensor reconstruction later when the skin has settled. Now, this is what a lot of members, a few of the members spoke about. You just do a skin suturing, wait, then we'll see how it comes out. If there's any problem, we can always go and do a flap. That is okay. So I call that the passive route. But it has got certain problems. One is uncertainty. You do not know whether it survived. You do not know how much of function you will get. You do not know whether the patient is going to come back for reconstruction. So all these problems are there. The second is called the active route. That is, remove anything that is doubtful. So there is no factor that is left to chance. You take over control of the hand. You take over control of the wound. So remove anything that is of doubtful viability. Aggressively fix the fractures beautifully. Augment the vascularity of the thumb if necessary. Primary tendon reconstruction can be done. And a primary flap, a posterior interoperative flap may not be enough. You can do a posterior interoperative flap or a free flap. There is no question of doing a pedicled flap for such patients when you're doing a primary tendon reconstruction. So this is what, this route also can be taken, and a lot of members spoke about this route also. A KY, just a KY, straight KY is more than enough. That would also have helped. Now we shall see what we did and what the result was. We followed the passive route. We just did a skin suturing. And we did not even fix the fractures. We molded the fractures. So the same lesson that we failed to learn with the previous case happened in this patient also. This was the immediate post-op. All the skin, when we debrided the skin edges, we found that there was bleeding. So we just did a skin suturing. And you can make out the fracture on the PPX. You can make out the fracture on the terminal phalanx and on the metacarpal, which have not been fixed. Because if you go in and fix, you're going to lose the viability of the skin. So you need to flap. That we did not do. It is ideal to do that. We did not do that. So this is the follow-up. Now look at the bones. They've all collapsed. I told you, when the comminuted fractures are there, they will not sit there. They will not heal just like that. They will collapse because forces are still acting. The tendons are acting. When the forces are acting, the load is there, the bones collapse. This is how it has collapsed. The wounds have healed, yes. All the bipedical flap survived, yes. But what was the resulting function? So the whole idea of these two cases, presenting these two cases yesterday and today, was to understand the importance of skin suturing and to understand the importance of early primary reconstruction. So what did we achieve? We took the passive route. We were lucky with the skin, but I do not know whether you can call it lucky because the fractures have not healed well, the extents have not been reconstructed. How much of function was achieved? Because there's acute flexion at the IP joint, there was stiffness at the CMC joint, and what is the time delay? Now, if we plan for reconstruction, it can be done. We can get back some amount of function, but what about the time delay? If we had taken the active route, active route definitely involves more amount of reconstructive work, but it somehow gives the control of the factors to the surgeon, and that might give a better result. So that was about the two cases, and before we finish and go in for the discussion, we'll discuss the what is Jolly Thomas palsy. You've heard of Klumke palsy, you've heard of Erb's palsy in brachial plexus injuries. What is Jolly Thomas palsy? Any ideas, any guesses? Okay. It is an intermediate palsy. Erb's palsy is C56 palsy. Klumke palsy is C8T1 palsy. And the intermediate palsy, that is C7 palsy, which is quite rare. And it does not manifest much. It is usually combined with the other procedure, with the other injuries. It is called an intermediate C7 palsy. And this usually occurs when the face presentation is converted. It usually occurs in obstetric palsy. Right. So now we shall have the discussion. I'm sure there has been a lot of discussion on the on WhatsApp and on Facebook. I'm sure we'll have to sort out a lot of things on this.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
If you are in ulnar nerve palsy, if you want to do a tendon transfer for claw correction and also for the pinch, the thumb key pinch, yes. Do you do them in the same stick sitting or do you do it in stages?
You can do it in the same sitting. I do it in the same sitting. I use one FDS, not in a high ulnar nerve palsy. In a low ulnar nerve palsy, I use one FDS for the lasso procedure. One is FDS is split into two, one for thumb adduction and one for index finger abduction. This procedure was described by, I think, Dr. Purushottaman does this procedure, if I'm not wrong. He does this procedure and I've sort of picked it up from some conference.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. Can you complete that formula, S3, M2 and...
Oh, sorry. S3, S1 is skin. You always look at the skin first. Make sure that the skin is all right. Only when the skin is all right, you go to S2, which is the S2 is the skeleton. The third S is the sensation. Okay. So if your skin is not all right, there is no point in doing any fixation. The skin must be perfectly all right. Then is the skeleton. Third is the sensation. Then it comes to M2. The first M is passive mobilization. For instance, you want to do a tendon transfer. If there is no passive range of movement, there's no point in doing an active tendon transfer. So first M is passive range of movement. The second M is active movement. So you have to get back first passive range of movement, then you have to get the active movement. And S3, M2, R. The R stands for rehabilitation, which is a matrix upon which all reconstruction, whether it is skin or whether it is muscle or whether it is a bone fixation, the matrix is rehabilitation, which comes in before the procedures, through the procedures, between the procedures and after the procedure. So that is my concept of trying to make it simple, of trying to understand complicated hand problems.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. I have several questions. Can I ask one by one, sir?
Yes, please.
What is the significance of dominance, sir?
Dominance, yes. Now, the thing is, I told you that day, we are talking about right hand. If it's a dominant hand, he needs more power, especially if he's a manual laborer. If in a manual laborer, it's going to be left hand, he may not be using that the same amount as this, as the dominant hand. So I feel that you need to concentrate more on getting more power for the dominant hand. Whereas for the non-dominant hand, if it is not possible to do, see, all our procedures, we do what is known as an ideal procedure and what is known as a stopgap procedure. If it is a non-dominant hand, you can do a static procedure. Whereas if it is a dominant hand, you need to do a dynamic procedure to give back power. It is a question of the usage of that hand. Now, we know that if the patient is a sedentary worker, you're going to do a different type of tendon transfer. If the patient is a manual laborer, you're going to do a different type of tendon transfer. So if it even a manual laborer, what work he is doing and whether the left hand is going to, the non-dominant hand is going to do the same amount of power has to be decided. That is the only thing. Otherwise, if for a manual laborer, both hands are going to be used, you need to have the same amount of reconstruction, both the hands.
Yes, sir. The next question is, in case of combined low, median and ulnar palsy, what is the order of the surgery in which you'll do and the time gap, sir?
Yeah. Now, the question is, in combined median and ulnar nerve, will you do the claw correction first or will you do opponent's plasty first? Isn't it? That's basically, I think, that's what
yes,
you want
with
to know.
The, yeah, pinch and I think pinch you can combine with claw collection. So, yeah, yes, sir.
So, that comes. So, all those come under ulnar and one comes under opponent's plasty. Generally, I mean, there are differing opinions. There is no, as I say, no, in hand surgery, there is no such thing as a right answer. But I generally feel that you do the claw correction first and then you bring the thumb. Why you should do the opponent's plasty second and why do the claw correction first? I believe that the thumb is the king. He will not come and wait for the fingers to come, for the subjects to come. That is on the lighter side. But when the thumb has been done, when the opponent's plasty has been done, if the fingers are like this and the opponent is going on, opposition is good, it will fail because it is not be used properly. Whereas a claw correction is more of a static procedure in the sense that it is only the flexion is going to continue, but only when the flexion is there, the thumb will be used. So the opponent's plasty must be done only when the fingers are ready to oppose to the thumb. I feel there is no point in doing just an opponent's plasty. It will not work after. He will not be able to use his hand. Whereas if you do a claw correction, he will use his hand at least for the basic work.
Yes, sir. The next question is, FDS, sometimes when you say you take the FDS and you split it like the bundle and then Littler's modification.
Yeah.
So it splits, suppose you take FDS, the strength is 2 and you split it into 4 parts. Does it become 0.5? Each becomes 0.5, sir?
Yeah, that is one of the basis for using a single FDS for 4 fingers. The analysis of the tension, they call it the tension fraction. Okay. It has been proved that that is why the original procedure failed because it caused too much of extension of the IP joints. It caused an intrinsic plus deformity. So that is the reason why it is. Now, does it mathematically break down? If I split into 4, does it become? Approximately, it breaks down. It becomes lesser. The important thing, as I said, was undercorrection is okay. Overcorrection is absolutely not accepted. So it is better to have a weaker muscle doing the procedure rather than having a more erring on the more powerful side is a problem. Erring on the less powerful side may lead to a recurrence of the claw, which has to be corrected easily. It is very difficult to correct a overcorrected claw hand.
Yes, sir. And you said you should add, when you said spoke about the Thangaraj splint, you said the addition of the wrist with the MCP should be around 90 degrees.
Yeah.
Is it for the extensor root or does it apply for the flexor root also, sir?
For all roots, it must be in this position. 0 at the wrist, 90 at this. 30 here, 60 here. Total flexion must be equal to 90 degrees.
Yes. And in case of ray amputation, you said for the index finger, the first case you discussed, have you heard a concept where they take off the head, when they take off the head of the metacarpal, the power grip reduces?
That's an interesting thing. Is the ray amputation really useful? Does a ray amputation or does it give a worse result? The problem with ray amputation is it is done mainly for two things. One is it increases thumb width. So in patients who have an intact index ray, no index finger, but a contracted thumb width, you can do a ray amputation because it increases the thumb width. The problem is it decreases the width of the palm. That is a disadvantage. That is why I said for this patient who has had an amputation, there is no role for primary ray amputation. It is only when there is a need for ray amputation, it is to be done. Now, your question was whether it reduces the grip. What was the question?
There's this thing where they say if the head of the metacarpal, say the index finger is taken off, the power grip reduces. That is the strength of the hand, the power grip reduces.
Yes. Now, the power grip also depends on the palmar surface. This itself is a power grip. Now, this is also reduced because the palmar width is reduced. Yes, definitely. Definitely, when a ray amputation is done, the power grip, there is a decrease.
Does that apply only to the border digits or even the central digits, sir?
That applies only to the index finger, only for the border digits. Now, for the central digits, usually we don't do a ray amputation. For a central digits, now the whole idea of a ray amputation is you remove at the base of the metacarpal. Okay, if you do a removal of the metacarpal up to the base in the third metacarpal, for instance, for the mid finger, if you do a ray amputation, what will happen to the index and ring fingers? They scissor. There will be a slight deviation of both the fingers. To avoid that, what you are supposed to do is what the textbook describes is. For the middle finger, if there has been an amputation of this finger, of the middle finger completely, don't do a ray amputation. Shift the index ray onto the
translocate
finger. Yes. Or for the ring finger, translocate the little finger to the ring finger ray. That is mainly to achieve cosmesis. Power definitely will come down.
No, the ray amputation for central digits, there was a paper.
Madam, can others ask questions, please? That Umar Farooq.
Sir,
Umar Farooq, what is your question? Yeah, Mushina.
Sir, good evening, sir. Sir, my question is, you had told when there is assisted angle zero, we usually do not take ECRL because it might cause PIP hyperextension as we are giving insertion in the lateral band. But suppose it is a manual labor where we don't want to take the risk of losing the power of the hand. In such cases, can't we still go ahead with ECRL and give a different insertion? Or is it absolute rule that if assisted angle is zero, we don't go for ECRL transfer?
No, you can go for ECRL transfer, but you should be very careful when you are inserting. Now, when I told you when you are inserting, when you go more distally, you are causing more extension. You remember that, isn't it?
Yes.
So, you have to limit your insertion to the proximal portion so that the power can increase. Definitely, there is no rule that says you should not do a transfer, but you should be very careful in those patients for whom Bouvier test is positive and unassisted angle is zero. Assisted angle is zero, then if you are using a powerful muscle, be careful, don't insert it into the extensor, insert it into the pulleys. So that is why we have got a wide range. You've got a wide range of motors, you've got a wide range of insertion, and you've got a wide range of routes. You can go on the volar side, dorsal side. So it is only a mix and match.
Meeting there because I need to start another meeting now.
Yes.
I'll end the meeting here, sir.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I had to start another meeting.